Okay. Hello. So I will try to present you the way I develop and the tools I use for developing, because I think they are particularly suited for driver development. So here we go. So I'm working at HAProxy in France. I've been a long time maintainer of now outdated kernel, I would say, since I have very few time to spend on this. I only pick very old versions. And for a very long time, I have been interested in installing Linux on every hardware. Here you can see the board of Zywall P1 VPN, for example, which used an ARM CPU, and it was possible but difficult to put Linux on it. But I did it so late that it was never merged anyway. So my main job consists in developing HAProxy, which is a network load balancer. A network load balancer is a special component in that almost all the time is spent in the system. So whatever you optimize, you realize that the code you put in your development is not very very much used. In fact, you spend most of the time in the system, and each time you try to understand why an optimization does not work, you have to understand the effect on the system behind it. For example, just an extra syscall can be very expensive, and you focus all your efforts on the system, the network stack, and the drivers all the time. Another thing which is a bit connected to this activity is to develop stress testing tools for HAProxy or the network stack. Here the only goal is to be efficient and fast, and you don't even want to publish your work because it's absolutely ugly. I have some example of patches, patched drivers which I use to saturate some network cards, for example. Some of them are able to eat and to produce line rate packets, but these are almost all the same packets, and you can only do this inside the drivers themselves. So, and it will never interest anybody else, so it's not really useful. But for my job, it's really interesting. And I also like to work with everything that I can connect to a computer. It started something like 25 years ago. I was still a kid, and I was already frying my parallel ports, plugging anything in them, so it has not changed. How do we test network components in general? Generally, you need at least three devices. You need the device which runs your code. You need a client and a server. We can find a number of variations of this simplistic architecture, but in practice, it's always the same principle. And what is the most important is that the testing devices must never be saturated before the tested device. Otherwise, you can't test your work. You don't know what is saturated and how your code is impacted. In practice, software becomes much faster than it was initially. The kernel has become much faster. For example, thanks to TCP splicing, HAProxy itself became much faster, and now it's very hard to saturate recent hardware. For example, on Xeon 3.6 GHz, I achieved 40 gigabits of HTTP traffic, and there was still 30% of idle CPU. So at this rate, you can't rely on just a simple architecture like this, because you quickly run out of network bandwidth or CPU on any device, and the test tools are so ugly that you can't monitor them anyway. So you need a lot of devices. And in practice, to achieve these speeds, you need at least 5 devices, so 4 devices around the tested device, and sometimes many more just to test your code. So this causes a problem. You can expect it. It requires a lot of space. It produces heat. It costs. It can be expensive because you have to afford the hardware. Sometimes you even need some switches. When you need a large number of machines, you can't plug them with the crossover wires. So it's already a problem. And another problem is also that when you are testing some experimental features, I have in memory the TCP fast open feature. You have to, for example, when you develop in the kernel or you are testing the kernel, if something does not work, you don't know if it comes from the testers or from the system you are testing, and you spend your time upgrading and rebooting all the systems because the client, the server, or the tested device can be faulty. So it's also a problem because you lose a lot of time rebooting and building kernels. So it's quite inconvenient in practice to work like this every day. The first idea that comes to mind is to use virtual machines. I used to do this a long time ago, but I stopped doing this when reaching high traffic rates because VMs are not really suitable for this. In practice, high packet rates are very sensible to latency and jitter. To give you an idea, at 10 gigabit, you have 67 nanoseconds to process a packet. This means that you have 15,000 packets per millisecond. So if you lose 1 millisecond because your CPU is scheduling between the user and the VM, for example, you can receive 15,000 packets with a small network buffers of around 500 packets. You lose most of the packets, or you have some flow control which stops the traffic. So in practice, it's not really suited for this. It's also hard to reproduce numbers on virtual machines when they run on a desktop system because you have some applications running on them. You never get exactly the same numbers between runs. So it's difficult to test micro optimizations. And SMP virtual machines can do some random things. You don't know exactly how they schedule the CPUs. You can, for example, have virtual CPUs which switch between physical CPUs, and you will not always reproduce some locking bugs. There is a problem with reproducing the emulation which does not reflect the reality. For example, on a real hardware, you can get on a network, you can get packets very fast, but there can be some space between the packets which will prevent the drivers from aggregating them. On a VM, due to the latency, due to the extra latency, you can see all the packets delivered at the same time to the driver, which will be able to optimize them, but it does not work in real life. So you don't get the exact same behavior as well. Sometimes also, when you are dealing with very high memory bandwidths, you don't know what you are testing in a VM because some drivers are doing extra memory copies, or you don't know exactly what happens behind. And when you want to play with some hardware, you can't connect your VM to a breadboard and to a few circuits. So another option is to consider a small hardware. In fact, it happened to me a bit by pure luck. I wanted to use some hardware for a few small production servers, and I realized that 2 months later they were still lying on my desktop, serving for testing purposes, and I realized that they were much more handy and convenient than big hardware or VMs for testing. The first thing is that when you are working on portable code, you generally don't depend on specific hardware nor specific features. So in theory, you should be able to run your code on anything. You have a number of architectures available right now, x86, ARM, MIPS, which are very common. You have a wide range of devices in these architectures. Generally, it means that you will have to cross-compile, but there is nothing wrong with this. I usually see a number of people who are afraid by cross-compiling because they imagine it's very complex, and once you build your toolchain, it doesn't change anything. The good thing is that the small hardware is easier to saturate than larger hardware. So. On my previous diagram, I can remove a large number of machines because I have much smaller CPUs, for example, smaller memory bandwidth, etc., which considerably reduces the global hardware performance and emphasizes the effect of my code versus the hardware. So. For example, the small memory bandwidth makes it very visible when your code is doing too many memory accesses because it has a big effect. While when you are running on a large server, a Xeon, or I don't know what, you have tens of gigabytes per second of memory bandwidth, and if you do an extra memory copy, you don't notice it. The few CPUs are interesting also because you have less branch prediction, for example. The hardware is not forgiving, I would say. There are less optimizations done by the hardware, and if your code is not clean, it will run slower. What I could say is that I found that the small hardwares run much like the large ones, but with all numbers scaled down. For example, I said that it took around 67 nanoseconds to process a packet in 10 gig networks. At 3.6 gigahertz, it's around 250 CPU cycles, which turns into approximately 1,000 instructions. So you can see that a large server will be able to spend at most 1,000 instructions per packet at 10 gigabit. On a small device, one gigahertz device, single core, an ARM Cortex, for example, you will have around 2,000 instructions to process a packet at 1 gigabit. So it's about the same order of magnitude, in fact. The effect that you get at 10 gig on a large hardware, you see the same at 1 gig on the small one. There are a lot of benefits of using these devices. Compared to VMs, you have some multiprocessor platforms right now, a large choice, so you can detect the locking bugs that you cannot always see in VMs. Another interesting point is that on SoCs, most of the devices, for example the network interfaces, are included in the CPU, and you can access them with a very, very low latency. So most of the time is spent in your code and not accessing the device. And this also contributes to emphasizing the effect of your code. The network performance, because I'm mostly concerned by network performance due to my job. The network performance is really good on some devices. You can find multiple gigabit links. Gigabit is fine because lower speeds, like 100 megabits, are too slow to saturate a recent CPU core. And at 10 gig, you can't connect your laptop on them to work with them. So the gigabit is the good balance between slow CPU and available hardware on your desktop. And there is a large choice of buses to connect any type of device, PCI, USB, I2C, etc. You can play with many devices that you connect on small boards and have the same effect while running the same driver later on the target platform. Another big benefit is the cost. Right now, when you want to work with a 10 gig server, you have to spend around 1,000 euros just to have a dual port NIC and the server. To give you an idea, I buy myself all the small hardware that I use for my tests because it's very, very cheap. A BeagleBone Black is $45 only. So you don't have to think. You just see it on the site and you look for the buy now button. I've used some Alix a lot. They are around $100. Around, I don't remember the exact price, but it's about this. The Mirabox from GlobalScale is slightly more expensive, but still affordable, and it provides a PCI and gigabit port and USB 3. So you have a number of interesting devices. At these prices, you don't mind if you fry them, because if I fry my my BeagleBone Black, I will just buy another one, and that's all. I carry them in my bag. I have some in my bag, I will show them. It's the same if I scratch them because I walk on my bag on in the train. It's not a big problem. And another thing to consider is that some manufacturers are willing to offer you some hardware if you ask them. Because these hardware are not very expensive, but some higher range are more expensive, and sometimes you don't want to spend 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 euros or dollars on the hardware. And if you have a good project, sometimes you just contact them and you ask them if you can use their devices, and it's very common that they accept. I did it 5 or 6 years ago with Miricom. They offered me a complete lab. I had 10 gig cards, for example. I would not have had the money to buy them. Recently, Platom offered me an OpenBlox AX3, which is a very nice device, and it's thanks to to Thomas. So it's a really, really nice device to develop on network. It's not very expensive, but when you just want to use it on some personal projects, you don't want to spend, I would say, 400 or 500 euros on such a device. And it's really cool when the manufacturers are able to do this. So you just need to ask them, and generally they accept. Another good point of using small hardware is the silence. Anyone who has worked with a device on the table with a fan knows that it is very tiring, and at the end of the day you are very happy when you switch it off. So I only accept fanless hardware right now, and on rare exceptions, slower fans. Sometimes I slow them down myself, running them on 7 volts, or just replace the fans. Or sometimes I just unplug them and think, let's see if it fries. And generally it doesn't. Small devices don't produce much heat because if they don't have a fan, it means they don't produce much heat. So it's nice when you start running 4 or 5 devices at the same time. Another point that we often forget to say is that you have no dust when you have no fan. it's very common to see main boards full of dust because of the fans, and when you have no fans, they are clean. It takes very few space. You can stack the devices on your desk and don't worry about them. I don't need any hard disk either. When you have no phone, you don't want to hear a hard disk spinning. So basically, either you boot on from NAND, or from USB, or from network, or SSDs, or compact flash, you have a lot of choice, but you don't need any hard disk. And since they are very light, you can carry them anywhere you want. For example, I use the same devices at home and at work because I have some development kernels running on them, and I don't want to reproduce the same environment at every place, so I can bring them with me. For the power adapters, it is still a problem. You have a large choice of power adapters. Some devices can be powered over USB. When you can, you should consider this because it's much easier, especially on a desk where it's not very common to find mains plugs everywhere. So it's convenient to use USB when possible. There is another benefit from these limited devices, which is the kernel build time. When your hardware is very limited, it does not support many features, many drivers, you can and you should spend some time to reduce the kernel config. You start from the make dev config of your board, and you remove everything you won't use for your tests. For example, when I'm running some network tests, I don't want the sound or wireless or SATA or IPsec. Sometimes I use netfilter in these tests. And for other tests like I2C, for example, I will not use netfilter nor sound, nor any of them, by the way. So you can easily end up with a very small config which builds in a few tenths of seconds on a conventional laptop. And it's very appreciated when you are running Git bisect, because you know that running Git bisect, involves doing about 20 kernel builds, and all the time is saved in the bisect. However, you won't save anything on user land build time because the code is the same, and the fact that the hardware has less features does not mean anything for the user land. So you can't always win. Another point is that you will probably notice some large differences between the build time between various compiler versions. If you know that you are not dependent on the compiler, you should really pick the one that provides the best balance between features and build time. It's easy to achieve two or three times the performance ratio between compilers, and when you compile a lot, there are huge savings on this point as well. And keep in mind, it's not the target platform. So if you don't produce the same code as you would expect, or the same exact optimizations you would expect on the target platform, it's not a problem. The boot time is a place for a huge gain as well. A PC can easily take 1 minute to get to the login prompt. If you have a PXE or a red card, it's even worse sometimes. So you prefer to do some awful acts such as writing to devmem to modify some code instead of rebooting because it's faster. On small hardware, in general, it's much faster. Booting in 10 seconds is something quite common, and you can even optimize this further by using a small RAMFS, for example, as a rootFS. What I found convenient also to save on boot time is to keep a list of copy-pastable commands, because you often have to switch between various sets of boot command lines or such things, and having them easily copy-pastable in a terminal is very convenient. So I have few files with a lot of commands that I can simply copy paste in Minicom and see my device immediately boot. It seems stupid, but in fact, you save a lot of time with such a simple method. I also find that the bootloaders are great. They could be improved. However, what I like with small devices is that, contrary to what you generally use on PCs, you can edit the configuration from the bootloader. And sometimes it's annoying to see that on a PC you have to boot to a complete running system just to update an entry in the bootloader or to change the default settings for next boot. But on many devices you can edit the environment, you can save, you can upload or download a kernel, an image. You can do a number of things. It's already very convenient. But I find that the line editing tends to suck a little bit, but probably it will improve. Another nice point is to catch the kernel panics. We are used to see some people send some snapshots taken from their cameras with just the end of Enoops and or kernel panic. And so it's annoying because most of the time they don't do the work of rewriting them by hand, so we have to do it ourselves. On such devices, you don't have the problem. You are connected using a serial cable. You grab everything in your terminal. You just copy-paste and you decode the OOPs, or you can archive it. You can do a lot of things much easier than with a conventional PC plugged on a VGA port, for example. Concerning the console, what is very important is that the console is accessible from outside of the box. It's very common to see a lot of small boards with internal console access, but when you close the box, you don't have access to it anymore. So you should not be afraid of drilling a hole in the plastic and solder wires inside, because you really need the console. Small devices, in addition to being cheap, are much more resistant to my torture, I would say. For example, if you switch off and on a PC very fast, sometimes you don't know why you end up in the BIOS and it says that it lost that the previous boot didn't work well, and or you have to press F1. On small devices, you don't have this because most of the time there is not even any BIOS. You just have a bootloader, so you can turn off the power at any time during the boot. You don't care. You won't kill any hard disk by your power cycling very fast when you try to reproduce a bug. You don't care. There are just low currents, so you won't put your house in fire by soldering something in them. For example, I recently added some RTC support on Dockstar, and I soldered the power wire at the wrong place. It did not turn on, but nothing fried. It's appreciated. You don't need any special packing, no protection in your bag. You just throw the board in your bag and get back home, and you don't care. It's cheap, so if you scratch one board from time to time, it's not very much of a problem. But power adapters are still a problem. Now that I have a 12-volt device, which is OpenBlox, I am very, very careful about the plugs I connect to my boards. I have already modded my Dockstar to work on 5 volts instead of 12, but I won't be able to do that on the OpenBlox, so I am very careful. And I don't want to fry the other devices with a 12-volt adapter. What is nice also is that you can play with a large number of settings. To take the Dockstar as an example, I could double the memory bandwidth just by playing with memory controller registers. And you can as well reduce the PCI bandwidth or the priority between the various devices on the board. And it's interesting because when you are testing your code, you want to ensure that it is your code which is the limiting factor and that they are not the devices or whatever. And for example, if you slow the memory by half and you see your program run half as the slow, you know that your code is very much depending on the memory bandwidth. So you can work on this. You can stuff a number of very standard components. I said that many boards support USB, PCI. So people who develop some drivers for, I don't know, maybe a Wi-Fi, USB dongle, or I don't know, whatever, or webcam, for example, you can easily plug these USB devices on many small boards because you will have the same behavior on every other hardware after that. PCI is very interesting as well. I have done some developments for Intel drivers, and it took some time. It was using the NetMap patches, which are not mainlined, unfortunately. These patches require an Intel NIC, and I didn't want to have a server on my desk. And I could buy a small, inexpensive dual port NIC which plugs in a PCI, in Mini PCI Express. I could connect it to the Mira box and run with it. So it was very convenient because in the end, my driver worked and it worked the same with other hardware. You have I2C as well, which is almost universally present. We used it for the power distribution board and. Our load balancers, for example, and some of the work was done on some Alix boards. Another part of the work was done on some ARM boards. In fact, you take whatever you have under the hand, and it's convenient. But everything is not good. There are also some drawbacks to using different hardwares. For example, if your code relies on some ASM optimizations or extensions which are very CPU specific, you probably won't get them on different boards. For example, some bit manipulations, SSC, you don't have SSC on Atom. For example, you don't have an integer divide on many ARM CPUs. Which is inconvenient if your code needs a lot of divides, sometimes just to compute some timings or whatever. The performance counters are not always present either, and the performance counters are very convenient to profile your code and see where you are spending sometimes. So if you don't have them, sometimes you take more time debugging your code. Some timing dependent bugs can sometimes only be reproduced on the target system. There are some boards which are not mainlined. It is a problem when a board is not mainlined and you want to work on some kernel drivers because you spend most of your time trying to work with the provided kernel which is not standard, on which you can't apply some fixes which have already been mainlined. It's a problem, so if you intend to work on the kernel, you should really avoid such devices because they end up wasting your time. Some boards are also hard to get to boot, such as the Snowball. There are some complex command lines with memory mappings and numerous out of three drivers. And sometimes you spend the whole weekend trying to get your hardware to boot and you realize that it was not a good choice. And I also discovered some issues with some hardware which have some limited capacities. For example, if you buy some gigabit enabled boards, you will sometimes find that the network interface cannot work at full speed. You are limited to half of the speed. And sometimes, for example, on some many or maybe most Samsung boards, the Ethernet is provided only over USB, so you won't achieve a gigabit either. So if you want to work on optimizing your network code and realize that you're wasting your time waiting for a device, it's not a good choice either. And sometimes some patches which you want for your target product are not available on some platforms. I took the example of Netmap. In fact, Netmap required a special NIC. It was fortunate that I could find a NIC which I could plug in my device. Otherwise, I would have to switch to another device. And obviously, you need to test on the target system from time to time. You can't consider.
Just a comment on, because we are developing on SSE and the next generation of Intel Atom.
Yes, the next, yes. But not the current one. Okay, so you need to test on the target anyway. So you will save some, most of the time, I would say, most of the development time and setup time, but you need to test from time to time on the target. A very important point. I said that you will be cross-compiling when using different boards. I have been used to waste my time building my own toolchains in the past, and I think that whoever has ever maintained his old toolchain does not want to do it anymore. So right now I'm using CrossToolNG. It's really good. You need to understand that compilers, binutils, and whatever the products you can find in a toolchain are full of bugs, but full of bugs, really. There are the make files, the code itself is full of bugs. There is no serious maintenance, in my opinion, and all these bug fixes must be centralized somewhere. And I find that it's properly done in CrossToolNG, and most of the time, when I can't achieve a build on my own, I realize that CrossToolNG managed to do it because someone has already faced the same issue and reported it. So use it and send your feedback and your issues, because it helps everyone who uses it. It's important not to insist on getting your preferred board to work, because you can have a number of devices you want to work with, or you are used to work with, but if for a specific task you can't use your board, it's counterproductive to spend weeks trying to port the feature to your board because it's not the target. So just pick a board which works for what you want to do. Also, don't try to estimate or establish performance ratios between small boards and the target device. That never works, in fact. I said that in practice, numbers could be considered at a scale down, but it's not exactly true. For example, sometimes IOs are very powerful because the devices are inside the chip, so the latency is very small, but you have a small memory bandwidth, you may have no branch prediction. So there are a number of differences. On average, you can establish a ratio, but that does not last long, and if you significantly modify your code, you will observe different ratios. So you still need to work with the target platform from time to time to provide some numbers. And before considering that your job is complete because you saved half of the CPU cycles, verify again on the platform. because sometimes you have just overcome a limitation of your board and not which was not a problem for the target platform. A few hints. Generally, I prefer Little Endian instead of Big Endian because when you run in Big Endian, if you have some bugs such as an H2NL missing somewhere, you don't notice it. While in Little Endian, you will immediately notice it. So it's better. And on some platforms, you can have some alignment traps which make your code crash if your code accesses misaligned data. It's important to do this as well because other platforms will not support this, and you prefer to see the bugs during the development. Using a very minimal kernel saves the build time and boot time because you have to boot the kernel from network or NAND or whatever, and the smaller it is, the faster it boots. Same for the rootfs, having even a very small initramfs with no or almost no modules or almost nothing in it saves on boot time as well. Remember that you are working with a development platform. You don't need any security on these platforms because security on this platform just wastes your time. So you put your SSH key in the root account, you log in as root with no password, and if you need a password, you use something very easy to type over a slow console, and use the short names for all your devices as well. Because at the end of the day, you save some time typing the names. It's important to have all the required tools in the rootfs. I have been lazy in the past, and for example, I was used to have a script which used to SCP all the tools I needed into slash TMP after the board has booted, and it's really boring. So it's better to rebuild the rootfs with all the tools. The root over NFS can be nice as well because you can more easily add many tools in them. But when, like me, you are working in a network environment, it's sometimes problematic because you spend your time unloading and reloading modules. And when you realize that your root was accessed behind your module, you just have to reboot. And you will definitely have to keep some patches. For example, I have one in mind which removes the plus in the kernel names when you build from a Git repository. If your kernel is patched and not committed, you have a plus which is appended at the end of the versions, and it annoys me for some automated tools. So I have some patches to remove this, for example. Yes, but the plus is appended after the local version. That's why I keep a patch. No, if you have the empty local version, what you remove, in fact, is the Git version, which is also appended. And you get rid of this, but not the plus if your code is not committed. Anyway, it's not a big problem, but the issue with keeping such patches is that when you are running a Git bisect, you don't have your patches and you don't want to apply them all the time over your Git tree because it's really annoying. So that's another reason for using the smallest patch set possible when you know you are doing some kernel work. And if you require a board, if you use a board which requires a number of patches, it will never work in practice. And when you work with devices which are very easy to hack, you are tempted to add a lot of features or a lot of crap, I would say. Don't push them upstream, because if you realize that it only interests you and nobody else, for sure you don't want someone else to maintain these patches for you, because it would be a bit selfish. So sometimes you can just publish your patch, post them on a list saying, hey, I have done that. If someone wants it, it's here. And if your patch is not adopted, don't fight to get them pushed and merged. A few hints about the kernel. To build using a cross-compiler, it's really not difficult at all. I wanted just to show this, to insist on this fact. You just force the arch and the cross-compile variable to point to your cross-compiler prefix, and that's all. What is very convenient is to enable early printk, which displays all the messages you get at boot, which normally you would not get because the system has crashed very early in a driver. Saving the config in slash prog slash config.gz is very convenient. It's the second variable. Because when you boot a lot of kernels on a board, after some time you don't remember exactly which boot used what setting. So it's very convenient to have this in the kernel which boots. And I found that DevTMPFS is convenient as well, because when you switch between various kernel versions, you always have your devices. You don't need the UDEV or whatever, and the kernel provides the devices that you need. So you save some time on this as well. If you are developing some drivers, it's better to have some modules to avoid rebooting, needlessly rebooting. But some drivers don't. And some boards don't support well running as modules. For example, there are some drivers, some devices which enter a low power mode when they are not used, and they lose some settings. So if you want to use them as modules, you have lost some settings. So it's just an example. So, but when it works, it's better. I also find that it's more convenient to use many small config files, depending on what I want to do, than using a large one, because a large config is longer to build, longer to boot, harder to debug, and having a specific configs is much easier. Also, an important point is to work and to base your work on mainline. It's very frustrating to work on an old version and see your system start to work and realize that the subsystem you have been using has changed a lot since the version you have used for your work. So it's better to work on mainline. And from time to time, it will not work. And you can just send some bug reports, and it helps the maintainers of the faulty subsystem to fix them. You should absolutely keep all your experimental kernel versions. I still don't do it all the time, and each time I forget to save a config which boots, I regret it. Because sometimes you just change a very small thing, and you spend the whole day trying to find what you have changed and the reason why it does not boot anymore. So if a kernel boots, you save the config somewhere, you put a number, you put the date, you put whatever you want in it, but you keep the config. It's very important. I also like to dissociate the kernel from the rootfs. Having the modules in the rootfs and the kernel in another image is really not convenient, because you have to perform updates in several steps. So I used to embed my kernel modules in the initramfs, which is provided with the kernel image, and I can boot whatever kernel I want with a single rootfs, or switch the rootfs if I want to test some other user space tools. And I have a script which does this, and even appends the device tree tables at the end of the image, and uploads everything at the right place. This saves some time as well. What my kernel looks like is this. When I build my I will first explain the principle. This is my BZ image. I have. Take this. No. Mm-hmm. No. Ah, wrong. Okay. Okay, this is my my BZ image. So the kernel I have built, it contains an initramfs in which I have just a small script which is called preinit, which is parsed by this init binary, which is very small as you can see. I have tar and all my modules. Tar comes from BusyBox. It's just a small tar statically built. It's very small. And my modules. And when the kernel boots, it executes this, it untars the modules, it moves the directory into the rootfs after mounting the rootfs. I've been used to put them in /boot and not /lib because I've done this for a very long time and I found this much more convenient, especially when you want to remove some kernels because you have a system.map, a config, the BZ image, you remove everything at once by just removing boot slash the version. So anyway, the system just mounts the modules here and then executes the real init from the rootfs, and the system boots and finds its modules. And it's very easy to do, in fact. You just run a make prepare because you need some includes to be prepared. You build your modules, you make a module install in a temporary directory, and you will have all the modules there. You build the module .tar here using tar from the directory used here, and you just have to finish the boot process. You use a BZ image, you image whatever you want, and optionally you can even make the device tree and append them to the image. And you put that on the NAND or TFTP server or what you want, and your system is ready to boot. So this is very easy to script and very fast, and it happens to me to perform sometimes two boots in a single minute because I boot first, it fails, and I just change an option, rebuild and boot again, and the second time it works. So in practice, you stay focused on your work. In fact, you don't get distracted by emails or whatever you can imagine while the system is building or booting. Concerning user space, you need to optimize your boot process because very often the time is wasted in services at boot. You don't need them, so you just need to disable them. You should not use anything which requires some network connectivity, such as a DNS, especially if you're not connected all the time or hacking some network drivers. The rootfs could appear in various forms, in RAM, loaded by the bootloader, or from compact flash, or NAND, USB, or NFS, of course. Use no password for sudo. I said it previously, no root password means less time spent on this. If you boot multiple devices which do almost the same job, it's convenient to have a local config. It's not always possible depending on the device you are using because sometimes you have just a read-only rootfs or you just boot from RAM. So you have just to use some tweaks, for example, just to detect the MAC address of your device, have a script which has set a network, the network settings or the host name or starts some scripts just based on the MAC address, for example. Or if you can save a local config on NAND or microSD or USB, it's more convenient. Never use the same IP address on multiple devices. We are all lazy, we all do this because you use the default address and you realize that sometimes you connect to the wrong device because you left one running somewhere under a pile of crap and you didn't notice it anymore. So assign a different address to each device when you install them. Have all the tools which are needed to debug and test your performance. So a few examples, S-Trust, TaskSet, Top, VMStat, Perf, TCPDump, IFRate. These are all small tools which are absolutely needed to debug your code and measure it. You will also need a GDB, but a GDB is much larger, so you will probably not have it on the rootfs, but copying it to slash tmp from time to time to generate a core can be useful. And you need it also in cross form to debug a core from your build system. I discussed about the ability to copy paste commands, boot commands. It's also true for setup scripts. For example, I set all my IP addresses by copying some sections from text files. If you play with the network, try to reserve a port for the admin. Sometimes it's not possible because you need two ports when you have only two ports, for example. But using Ethernet over USB can be an option for the administration because you don't need speed for SSH. Just a few hints to build your own rootfs. In fact, you just need an init, and BusyBox does that very well. Slash dev, you can use dev tmpfs, so you need nothing there. Slash proc, slash sys, there are pseudo file systems. You don't have to do anything except creating the directories. And everything that goes in slash bin can be provided by BusyBox. I have a rescue rootfs which contains everything and just does a BusyBox minus install at boot, and it's very easy to build, and you get a fully functional system which is enough to debug a lot of code. It's not complete. You can't do complex things with them, but when you work on the kernel, wow, it's time to finish. Yeah, you can boot very quickly with this, and there are many options to build your own rootfs. There are some distributions or projects which do this very well. For the boot, you have many options. The kernel can be on a local storage, such as a file system. On a PC, it's common, using grub, syslinux. On a NAND, using uBoot, for example. Remote storage for PXE or TFTP. Then it's loaded into RAM by the bootloader. For the rootfs, you have more options. You can mount a local block device. You can use a local storage NAND using UBFS, for example. NFS, I have said it, and you can load a block device into RAM and mount it as a RAM 0, for example. It's very fast as well. And you can have your init RAM FS embedded in the Z image. What I find in practice is that loading an image from the network at the gigabit speed is faster than loading from a local device. Which itself is faster than loading over 100 megabit network. So in general, I tend to use only the network and boot in TFTP. My platforms of choice are the Dockstar when I just need a 1 gigabit port because I can power it over Ethernet. OpenBlocks when I need some SMP or a large network performance, many Ethernet ports. The Mirabox when I need some PCI because it's very accessible. Alix for 32-bit x86, an Atom for 64-bit, but it has a fan, so I don't use it very often, and it's very hot. And the Guru plug that I have modded for I2C. And an example of how I can connect multiple devices together and just have a very small platform to test HA proxy. I run just a server here, HA proxy here, the client on my laptop, and it is a very small lab which works exactly like the large one I showed on the first pages. Ideally, I would like a board which is the size of a BeagleBone Black. I will show you this. With a few gigabit ports and powered over USB, but it's not that easy. Okay. is your BeagleBone Black. You can see it's very small. You can have it in your pocket. You can build a network platform, stacking 10 of them together if you want, and it's still cheaper than a PC. The Mira box, well, some people have it with a plastic box around, but mine looks like this. So you can see these are very small and cheap devices and very convenient. And here is what I have in my bag all the day. So the conclusion to this is that with this price, there is no excuse for not working on the kernel because you can have very affordable devices and it's accessible to everyone. Thank you.
What did you do to them?
No question?
Nice. There is one.
So what's the next device you're looking at?
I don't know yet. I don't know yet. I have seen that Marvel proposes some Armada 375, which are dual core with 2 gig links, and I find them very interesting for my usage because the Mirabox is a single CPU core, so I can't test SMP code on this. I'm interested in seeing what they will provide, but I have not seen any board yet.
And the more serious question. So you were mentioning that this is all C based, so that it's so portable. You don't have any assembler section to it.
In my code, I have a few assembler sections, but it's C based anyway because there are some fallbacks. The code is portable to every platform, so it's not a problem in practice.
Other question?
How many times did you encounter a bug that was dedicated to this small target instead of having it on a real hardware?
I don't even remember having got this issue, in fact. The main problem I get using such platforms is to get the platform to boot. But that's why you really need to select your platforms and get the ones that boot the easiest way and which is supported in mainline. But if the system boots, in practice, you have no problem with portable code. Yes, I remember one bug, a problem with alignment traps on ARM. In fact, it did not do a trap. It used to just try to fix the words which were loaded in memory, and the words were reversed by default, the way they were loaded. And I got some bugs in Nginx on this, and I thought that Nginx had a bug, but in fact not. And enabling the alignment trap has allowed me to discover the bug.
So, last question.
The Raspberry Pi is doing a lot of buzz nowadays. I noticed that you didn't mention it. No. So, is there a reason?
Yes, there is a reason, in fact. The reason is very simple for me. I work in network environment, and as I said, I need gigabit ports because with less than gigabit, and I cannot saturate the CPU. So it's just a waste of time for me to use smaller devices. That's why it's hard for me to find interesting platforms. I seek every Saturday. I wander on the web to see if new boards are available, and gigabit is starting to slowly appear, in fact. No, I have not tried.
Thanks, Willy.
Thanks.